Good afternoon. My name is Kimberly Begg. I'm a Vice President and General Counsel here at Young America's Foundation, and it has been a great privilege of mine to serve as a part of our excellent team for the last 14 years. It was Young America's Foundation that first introduced me to the conservative movement when I attended a regional conference in Connecticut when I was a junior at Rutgers University. Ron Robinson spoke at that conference, as did a number of other prominent conservative Catholics, including William F. Buckley and Judge Bill Clark. They were concerned about efforts by the radical left to infiltrate Catholic institutions with the goal of shifting power away from individuals, families, and churches to the state. They would be very pleased that you are all here today, as is our next speaker today, Leila Miller. It is my absolute pleasure to introduce you to Leila Miller today. During this seminar, you will hear a lot about how it is a confusing time to be a Catholic. Leftists in government, the media, and academia are deceiving young people into believing that being a faithful Catholic means adopting the left's ideology. Our next speaker came of age at another confusing time for young Catholics. Leila Miller was born in the late 1960s. Her post-Vatican II religious education reflected the feel-good attitude of the times. God is love. Love is good, so everything that feels good must be from God. Her Boston College education reinforced these themes. Consequently, Leila, like so many students at Catholic schools, graduated with a poor understanding of her faith and therefore her vocation. Then a book changed Layla's life. This book was written by one of the key conservative student activists in the 1970s, a co-author of a book-turned-film that YAF distributed broadly to students across the country. Many conservative leaders today cite that project as shaping their ideas about the role of government in our lives. That author was Carl Keating. You may know Carl Keating as the acclaimed author and founder of the apologetics group Catholic Answers. When Leila first read Carl Keating's Catholicism and Fundamentalism, she was living a pretty typical life for someone who was catechized in the 1970s, in that her faith largely did not guide her behavior. But then Carl Keating's clear presentation of the truth changed everything. Since then, Leila has dedicated her professional career to doing what Carl Keating did for her, communicating with clarity, color, and light. Leila does not sugarcoat. She does not shy away from weighing in on sensitive religious and public policy issues. Citing Dennis Prager, a popular Young America's Foundation speaker and conservative talk radio host, she says she prefers clarity to agreement. Leila first became known as a Catholic writer through her blog, Little Catholic Bubble, but she has now moved to books. She is the author of two books and is currently working on a book for Catholic Answers with Trent Horn on how to talk to children about the tough moral issues. Leila has been featured on EWTN, National Catholic Register, Catholic Answers Magazine, The Patrick Coffin Show, Crisis Magazine, Catholic World Report, Our Sunday Visitor, and Relevant Radio, among others. She is also featured in Patrick Madrid's book, Surprised by Life. Leila and her husband have 8 children and several grandchildren, and they reside in Phoenix. I will leave you with this quote by Jennifer Fulweiler, the popular host of her radio show on Sirius XM and the author of the acclaimed book, Something Other Than God. Jennifer Fulweiler said, "Leila Miller is a powerhouse. She is one of the rare people who speaks truth fearlessly, yet always with love. I admire her tremendously and encourage everyone to listen to what she has to say." Please join me in welcoming Leila Miller.
Hi, everyone. Oh, my goodness. It's great to see you. I told Kimberly, keep me on track. Sometimes I go off on tangents, but if you're lucky, I'll stick to my script and my time. All right, So as the first speaker, I'm very, very happy to be able to kind of lay a little bit of a foundation for you as to what you might hear the rest of this weekend, and lay a foundation for you to be able to kind of fight off what you might be hearing even on Catholic campuses and from Catholic people who might not share our conservative political views. So what we're going to talk about today is our Catholic responsibility in the public square with regard to things that are the non-negotiable issues and things that are matters of prudential judgment. So right there, there are three things that I want to define for you: public square, non-negotiables, and prudential judgment. I also, when I get finished doing some of that, I want to warn you about the common ways that people, especially Catholics on the left side of the political spectrum, tend to conflate or muddle those two issues, the issues of prudential judgment and non-negotiables, so that average Catholics and even faithful Catholics, such as ourselves, hopefully, get confused and we somehow sometimes can't respond or we don't know what to say. So first I'm going to define for you public square. So the public square is simply what we do and say and promote in public outside of our private homes and private lives. It's how we promote the common good in our own society, in our towns, our cities, our states, and the nation. And specifically, it has to do with voting. It has to do with laws and legislation. It has to do with the courts, the judiciary, public policy of all types, and how we govern and are governed. Okay, so that's the public square that I'm going to be talking about today, and what the Catholic Church says is our obligation in the public square. And we know that, like any other nation, America will fall or stand based on what happens in the public square. Now, in the public square, there are non-negotiable issues according to our faith, and there are issues of prudential judgment. And let's quickly define those before we move on to specific examples of each. So the non-negotiable issues are just that. There's no negotiating about the truth of them or where Catholics must stand on these issues. Catholics must be of one mind on these issues as they apply to our laws, our governance, our courts, our voting, and our public policy. Okay, it doesn't mean in our heart, we all agree. No, we're talking about the public square here, so keep that first and foremost in your mind. The non-negotiables are things that are so fundamental, so foundational to our human nature and to the functioning and flourishing of human society and the common good that they can in no way be legitimately infringed, not by any government, not by any person. Okay. So the issues then of prudential judgment, now we're moving on to that, are issues that Catholics may legitimately disagree about. These could be and often are very important issues, but we as Catholics are not required to agree with each other on the approach or the stand that we have on these issues when it comes to the way we handle them in the public square. Okay, so do you see the distinction? Okay, so we've got one is no leeway, no other way to think. And on the other side is, yeah, use your judgment, the best of your ability, and you decide maybe the most effective way that we could approach this issue in the public square. And we don't have to agree on that. Okay, that makes sense? So let's go on to specifics. First, the non-negotiables. Bishop Thomas J. Olmsted, who happens to be my bishop in Phoenix, I'm very blessed to have Bishop Olmsted as my shepherd, he wrote a booklet for Catholics on our role in the public square. And it's sort of a short catechism. It's actually numbered questions and answers. And it's called Catholics in the Public Square. I highly recommend you get it. I'm sure it's very cheap. It's just a little tiny booklet. Or you can go to, you can Google it online, and the whole thing is just right there online. It's very, very quick and easy. But print it out or get it. It's a perfect guide for you. In this very short but very clear guide for Catholic voters, Bishop Olmsted, and by the way, it's part of a series that the U.S. bishops did called A Shepherd's Voice. So it's kind of, and another bishop, the Bishop of Los Angeles, put a foreword. So it's a statement that doesn't just, it's not just his one little bishop's opinion. Okay. Bishop Olmsted talks in there about the non-negotiables. He quotes Pope Benedict in a 2006 speech to the European politicians. And Western Europe, as you know, is notoriously left-wing, secular place, post-Christian. And Pope Benedict said the following to those politicians. He said, as far as the Catholic Church is concerned, the principal focus of her interventions in the public arena, keep listening for those words, is the protection and promotion of the dignity of the person, and she is thereby consciously drawing particular attention to principles which are not negotiable. Okay, there's this whole thing that the Catholic left, I call them the Catholic left, will tell you, and they'll say that this whole idea of non-negotiables was something made up by Catholic Answers, because Catholic Answers happened to put out a little guide. But here's the word from Pope Benedict. So among these, he continues, among these, the following non-negotiables emerge clearly today. One, protection of life in all of its stages from the first moment of conception until natural death. Two, the recognition and promotion of the natural structure of the family as a union between a man and a woman based on marriage, and its defense, so we're now defending, and its defense from attempts to make it juridically equivalent to radically different forms of union, which in reality harm it, harm marriage and family, and contribute to its destabilization, obscuring its particular character and its irreplaceable social role. Okay, gay marriage, obviously. And the protection of the rights of parents to educate their children. And on that, under that comes the right to get them therapy, like if they want, you know, if they need help. The right to educate them in the Catholic faith and freedom of religion. So all that is in there. So let's go through that again. So the first section touches on, you know, the protection of life in all its stages. Abortion, clearly. Research on human embryos, human cloning, euthanasia, or physician-assisted suicide. All these things are direct attacks on innocent human life with the intent to cause death, okay? The intent to cause death. These things are intrinsically evil, which means of its very nature. Of their very nature, they are evil. Under no circumstances could they ever be permitted morally, ever, and no government could ever make something that's intrinsically evil be acceptable. If it's legal, then the government's wrong. There's no two ways about that. Next, the traditional understanding of marriage as the union of one man and one woman, a conjugal union, must always be upheld. That is the first foundation of any society, is marriage. And then, and let's talk more about that one. So Cardinal Ratzinger, before he was Pope Benedict XVI, was the head of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith for 20-some years. And under Ratzinger at the CDF in 2003, he said the following. In those situations where homosexual unions have been legally recognized, remember we're always talking about the public square, or have been given the legal status and rights belonging to marriage, clear and emphatic opposition is a duty. And I really want you to pay attention to all the words that I'm going to say here. Clear and emphatic opposition is a duty of Catholics. Okay? There's no, oh, well, you know, let everybody live, it's okay. That's not our faith. He goes on, one must refrain from any kind of formal cooperation in the enactment or application of such gravely unjust laws. Always listen for the word gravely. Gravely unjust laws. And as far as possible, from material cooperation on the level of their application. In this area of marriage, in the public square, everyone can exercise the right to conscientious objection. Okay? And he says, and for Catholic politicians to vote in favor of a law so harmful to the common good is gravely immoral. Gravely immoral. Okay. And finally, the rights of parents to be the primary educators of their children must always be safeguarded. So we see more and more movement away from that with in Europe. I mean, there's homeschooling is illegal, for example, in Germany, I know. I'm sure some other places, Sweden, or some of the really enlightened countries have actually removed children from the homes of Christians who are homeschooling. I think California wanted to outlaw homeschooling. And we have issues with the left wanting to take away parental rights, the parental rights to educate children. Now, parents can't get their teenagers, even if their teenager wants some type of therapy for having unwanted sexual attraction in whatever direction, they're not allowed to get therapy for their children. So we have, this is kind of gaining momentum in the, from the left. So we have to be very careful, because that's never, ever moral to usurp the role of the family like that. And interestingly, I'm just going to throw this out there because I find it fascinating, but in the Garden of Eden, at the creation of man, there were just a few things that had to do with humanity. And one was life itself. One was that we were created male and female. Another, that relationship was called a marriage. And then the marriage was for the purpose of raising up children and educating children. Okay, that can kind of help you ground what are these fundamental intrinsic things that can't be usurped. Okay, they've been there since before any government existed. These are pre-political things. Okay, so all those things are the first and foundational social justice issues. You guys hear a lot about social justice issues as young people? Like, I didn't really hear about that when I was growing up. That wasn't really a term, but now social justice warriors, obviously. So I know that's the big, everybody wants you to, you have to be on the right side of whatever social justice issue there is. Social means society. The society at its core is marriage, is a family. So anything that doesn't start from that is way off base. So the true social justice issues are the ones that I just talked to you about. And no other social justice issue can trump those. So those are the non-negotiables. Do we have that? Got it, okay. And I'm just gonna say this. A society, has been said, a society can survive its people doing evil things, but a society cannot survive its people saying that evil things are good and enshrining those into law. So these are serious issues. Okay, let's turn to the issues of prudential judgment. And I'm going to give you some quotes here, but the other issues, there's so many other issues. For example, immigration law, housing issues, health and welfare, education, environmental issues, gun control, just war, capital punishment, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, are issues of prudential judgment, or what we might call policy issues, where we're trying to figure out the best way to do things. Unlike the non-negotiables, these are the issues about which Catholics are free to disagree with each other and disagree even on a lot of those issues with perhaps what the hierarchy is saying of the church, and I'll get into that too. So prudential judgment, prudence, meaning being wise about something, applying common sense, knowing when to act or not to act, in what manner or degree. Bishop Olmsted says of these issues of prudential judgment, again in the booklet that you will love and you need to get, he says, on each of these issues, these policy issues, we should do our best to be informed and to support those proposed solutions that seem most likely to be effective. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, let's take poverty issues, for example. We Catholics are not free to ignore the plight of the poor. That's fundamental in our Christian understanding. And we know well that the poor and the downtrodden are a huge focus of our care. And, Jesus was really clear on that, right? So the question is not if we help the poor, the question is how best to help the poor. Same thing with things like education. It is not a question of whether or not we educate our children, and Catholics are really big in education. We founded the university system. So it's not that, it's how best to educate our children. And we can come to very, very and different conclusions on that front. And the church does not ask us to be in lockstep, and in fact, we can be as creative as we need to be in our solutions. Now I have something really fun and interesting. Immigration and borders. So I don't know if you realize this, but we are also free to disagree as Catholics with each other, and yes, even with the Holy Father, about the issues of immigration. And I'm going to tell you something that the mainstream press never reported, which is pretty common that they don't report a lot of things they should be reporting, right? About 14 months ago, I don't know if you remember, the press went insane when President Trump's temporary travel restrictions were going to go into effect. Do you all remember that? And they were presenting quotes from Pope Francis about welcoming immigrants and all this stuff that would make you think as a Catholic, okay, this is uncomfortable because I'm on the wrong side. I don't know what's happening here. Well, what they didn't report was that Pope Francis gave an interview that same weekend. And he said in a Spanish newspaper, and if any of you speak Spanish, you can go look at it directly, but here's the translation. He said, quote, "Every country has the right to control its borders, who comes and who goes. And those countries at risk from terrorism and such things have even more right to control them more." Okay, that was Pope Francis. He also stressed that Catholics have a right to disagree with him. Quote, "They have the right to disagree. They have the right to think that the path is dangerous, that the outcome may be bad. They have that right." Okay, so this is what I mean by an issue of prudential judgment. Does everybody got that? Okay. Now, would he ever say that Catholics or anyone had the right to implement legal abortion? Never. Never. So there's the difference right there. So let's go a little bit further. When someone on the left, or even a Catholic even on the left, insists that unless you support and advocate for some left-wing Democrat position or some massive federal social welfare program, that you are somehow not as Christian as you should be or as they are, and that you do not care about the poor, and they insist that unless you support the massive public education system that we have set up and which has basically failed our children, then you don't care about children, you don't care about education, you don't care about the poor. Well, they are not telling you the truth, and you don't have to believe them. There's nothing in Catholicism that says those things are true, what they're saying. They may truly believe it. They may truly believe that massive government bureaucracies on the federal level are the gold standard for everything, but you're not bound to agree with that as a Catholic and as a thinker. In fact, you're free to believe and say that those programs have actually been the source of great harm to those whom they propose to help. So, you know, we get it. Yeah, I mean, I can't tell you how many times I've been called hateful and bigoted and mean and terrible and evil and all that. Let it roll right off your back. So let's take a look at what the church says, because we look to Holy Mother Church's wisdom on these issues and not the wisdom of our liberal scolders. And we live in very weird times, so really we need to pay close attention to the wisdom of our church, which is timeless. So how many of you know about subsidiarity? A few of you, good, maybe half or so. And you'll hear more about this on this weekend, and we want to repeat this a lot so that you really get it in your brains. Subsidiarity is a Catholic principle, and it's one that everyone who really cares about social justice should be applying. And almost no one, or probably no one, on the left actually applies this Catholic principle. Subsidiarity holds that decisions and policies should be made at the lowest level possible, and intervention by higher and bigger social organizations should only be undertaken when those lower levels truly need and desire a supporting and not a usurping action. In other words, if something can be done by a smaller and more simple organization as opposed to a larger and more complex one, then it should be. When you think social, think society. Back to that. Marriage, family, is the simplest and most local organization in the social order. And it's truly the first society. It's followed by such organizations as the neighborhood, then civic organizations, city, state, nation, and the like as you go up. The more complicated, the more further removed and the more centralized an entity or an authority, the less effective, the more impersonal, and even more harmful are its interventions into areas that are proper to smaller and more local communities. Okay, we see that all the time. That's why we're conservative. Professor Anthony Esselin, whom I love, and if you really want to read about social justice, get his book, Reclaiming Catholic Social Teaching. It's brilliant. He says, families are not wards of the state. The state is rather something created by families, and the state must answer to them and not the other way around. Underlying these issues of prudential judgment, then, is this principle that underlines all that. When we look at issues of prudential judgment, we say, what level can this best be and would most effectively be accomplished at? As low a level as we can get. Pope Pius XI wrote of it in 1931, and he said that the most weighty principle of subsidiarity cannot be set aside or changed. It's fixed. In fact, he says, remains fixed and unshaken in social philosophy. Here's the word gravely again. Just as it is gravely wrong to take from individuals what they can accomplish by their own initiative and industry and give it to the community, so also it is an injustice and at the same time a grave evil and disturbance of right order to assign to a greater and higher association what lesser and subordinate organizations can do. For every social activity ought of its very nature to furnish help to the members of the body social and never destroy or absorb them. So anytime the state takes over a function of the family, for example, it has absorbed the lower society, and that's wrong. It's immoral. It's a disorder. 60 years later, Pope St. John Paul II warned of the dangers that come from violating this principle of subsidiarity, namely the modern welfare state. He calls it the social assistance state. He said, St. John Paul II, malfunctions and defects in the social assistance state, the welfare state, are the result of an inadequate understanding of the tasks proper to the state. Here again, the principle of subsidiarity must be respected. A community of a higher order should not interfere in the internal life and community of a lower order, depriving the latter of its functions, but rather should support it in the case of need. Okay, always with a view to the common good. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. I will say, he also said, the social assistance state, the welfare state, leads to a loss of human energies, an inordinate increase of public agencies, hello, which are dominated by more bureaucratic ways of thinking than by concern for serving their clients, and which are accompanied by an enormous increase in spending. Hello. In fact, it would appear that needs are best understood and satisfied by people who are closest to them and who act as neighbors to those in need. Okay, this is a Catholic principle. You don't hear leftism in here at all. Okay. So why do we let them intimidate us? That's a really big question. Maybe instead of being intimidated by them, we should educate them as to what Catholics really believe. Okay, so and another note, the cultural view of taking care of the poor or charity just means love, but you know, we use it in terms of helping monetarily or charity is not counted to us as righteousness or any kind of meritorious activity unless it is voluntary. So an involuntary forced thing is not a virtue. Love and charity is an act of the will, and it's an act freely given. So it just kind of cracks me up when you hear leftists tell you that, you know, you're not voting for higher taxes on all these different programs. And well, number one, it's because it violates subsidiarity and it does all those bad things that the Pope just said, the saint. But number two, that's not the way I love people. I mean, yes, I have an obligation to pay my taxes, yeah, not, absolutely, but that's not going to count when I stand before God for anything, because that was a forced thing, right? So if I'm gonna want to actually care for my neighbor and care for the poor, I have to do that myself. And I also have to give out of my non-tax money, because that's the voluntary giving that Christ talks about. So again, what are they talking about? That you have to be loving by having your taxes raised. I don't see any of them writing in their IRS forms, you know, yeah, I wanna donate some more. You can. They could donate a lot more money, and they don't for some strange reason. Ask them about that. Okay, so I want to give you an example of what happens when Catholics conflate the non-negotiables and the issues of prudential judgment, or when they deny there's really even a distinction. And I'm going to take as my example the number one non-negotiable in the public square, which is abortion, which is the right to actual life, like being alive, like staying alive. If the state can't, if the state has one job, it's to protect life, the life of its citizens, right? That's the number one job of the government, is to make sure the citizens are not wantonly killed. And unfortunately, we have a law in place now that has one whole class of human beings completely unprotected from murder. 60 million can attest to that. Okay. So you'll hear Catholics on the left say that we can't, you know, this law, you know, we tried. This is just not effective, this whole trying to get around abortion by, you know, changing the law back or protecting, you know, this whole public square thing. We need to change hearts, they say. And I say, well, yes, but that's a false dichotomy. We need to do both, right? The Catholics are obligated to work in the public square against abortion. That's like the number one big thing that everybody has always talked about. That's life is the foundational right from God. So we do that in the public square, and we also change people's hearts. We evangelize, we philosophize, we make friends, we do a lot of work, as you probably know, the pro-life work, pro-life movement does a lot of work with directly with women in crisis and children, families in crisis. Our crisis pregnancy center in Phoenix, that my husband's a president of the board of that, and we've been involved forever. We now have a father's program, a men's program, and we encourage the men to learn what it means to be a father and a husband, hopefully forming a family. So we do that. We've always done that for 45 years or more. The pro-life movement has worked on the hearts of people, and I've seen miracles. I've seen so many amazing things happen. But our friends on the left will tell us that we're just mean. We're just mean, and we just want to change a law that has, we can't possibly change it, and that hasn't worked. So I'm going to give you some concrete ways that they have proposed that we go about things, and I want to show you the fruit of what they've done. And by the way, I just have to say one thing. The law is not insignificant in pro-life. I have a friend who hadn't told anyone until she went to a Project Rachel retreat recently, that decades ago she had an abortion. And I asked her, actually, because I was kind of preparing all this, and I thought, okay, so she was a teenager. She told me specifically, she said, it was my choice. I absolutely chose to do this. I thought I was being, you know, autonomous, and I'm going to do this. And she wasn't Catholic at the time. But I said, you were a teenager. I said, if abortion had been illegal at the time, would you have had the abortion? And she said, no. Okay. Most people don't break the law in that way. So when people say the law, it doesn't matter, people are going to get abortions anyway. Some will. A very small percentage will still get illegal abortions. Most people follow the law. Most people will not break the law in those areas. So it's an absolute lie when they say the law makes no difference. It's just a lie. St. Ignatius says something that I kind of like to use. Look for the tail of the serpent. Okay, something like that. You can almost see the tail of the serpent just slithering in that conversation. Don't believe it. Okay. So there's this whole renewal of what used to be called the seamless garment. You guys do know what that is, the seamless garment argument for pro-life, which is that, well, we can't focus just on abortion. We have to focus on every other social justice issue in the world, right? So when we stretch the meaning of pro-life to include anything, and that's what I call it, the kitchen sinking, to throw everything but the kitchen sink into the pro-life umbrella, then you've just undermined the meaning of pro-life. You've undermined anti-abortion activism. Because it's conveniently not about abortion. It's not even necessarily halfway about abortion or even a third about abortion. It's anything social justice. And they can throw things in there as broad and as nebulous as economic factors, the environment, torture, sex education, gun control, women's justice, equal wages, health and welfare, and they have. So now pro-life means all of these things, supposedly. We're supposed to believe that. And what you get out of that is very telling, and I will give you concrete examples. I just want you to stay with me here. I'm going to use a specific group, and I don't want to give them more airplay than they need. But it's called the New Pro-Life Movement. I don't know if you've heard of it, but the New Pro-Life Movement was founded by two Catholics who started it during the last election cycle because they despise Donald Trump and they despise conservatism and conservative politics. They hated that conservative or that pro-lifers, because pro-lifers, no matter what, if that's the first and foundational issue, you're going to go with the candidate, the viable candidate that is most likely to, in the public square, do something as far as judges. Not just a Supreme Court judge. Everyone always said, oh, but the Supreme Court judge, which is great. He did a great job. Trump, you know, has given us a good Supreme Court justice. But people forget, there are lots of judges he appoints in the federal judiciary, lots of them. So he's placing pro-lifers in those positions. He's placing pro-lifers in key cabinet and underling positions. I'll read you one thing before I, and this could be a tangent. Stop me, Kimberly, if I'm too much. But my friend Uju, she has a book. It was with a foreword by Robert George, who is a YAF speaker, Professor Robert George. Her book is called Target Africa. She's a Nigerian woman. She happens to be a scientist now in London, but she spent Easter at my house. Has a new Ignatius Press book. And she talks about the colonization of her continent by leftist, progressive people who want to colonize all the immoral stuff that, you know, and tie it to foreign aid. And it's destroying her continent, morally. And a lot of the people doing it are Catholics. So when someone like the founders of the New Pro-Life Movement hate conservative values. I'm not going to say that they hate us. They hate conservative values. They do despise Donald Trump. But when they say how terrible he is, and he has nothing to do with pro-life, and it's just he's the least pro-life person ever, blah, blah, blah. And Hillary Clinton, by the way, they say, there's a whole group, they'll say that she was the more pro-life candidate. They will say that outright. These are Catholics. And she's a rabid pro-abort, rabid. Okay, so one thing that my friend Uju said, this is just one sentence, the degree to which the United States has been financing population control in the developing world helps to explain the shock waves that were felt by abortion providers when President Trump reinstated the Mexico City policy via an executive order. In the time it took for Trump to tweet a message, they lost half of their funding. She was rejoicing. Most of the continent of Africa was rejoicing. They don't want our dirty abortion population control money. They don't want it. And so for the founders of something like the New Pro-Life Movement to be, you know, constantly saying that Trump has no pro-life, you know, he's not pro-life at all. He's helping to get our millions of dollars of aid to basically kill African babies out of there. I would say that's pretty pro-life, in addition to the judges and all the other stuff, right? Okay. So I'm going to go through the 11 pillars of the New Pro-Life Movement, and you can identify how many of them are actually dealing with direct attacks on a human life. First is the right to life. Okay. But they set up an umbrella. They say, yes, humans have an absolute inherent right to life, and we believe that spans from conception to natural death. So far, so good. This includes both the protection and the sustainment of life at all stages. And it creates, they say, the foundation for the entire rest of their platform. The sustainment, now there's the key, there's the rub, right? Then they name their other 10. Abortion, yes, they're against it. But guess what? They're not interested in changing the law. Okay, public square issue, Catholics, this is a public square issue, law. Not interested, didn't work. So now we're just interested in making sure that the demand is lessened by making women more prosperous. Okay, where's this going? Right. In fact, they say that overturning Roe v. Wade would not be a pro-life win because it just throws it back to the states. Well, yeah, we have a lot of pro-life states. Hello, that would be a good thing. That's a start, right? So let's keep going in that direction. Number two pillar, euthanasia. There's kind of a statement, you know, we don't like it, but not much about fighting it, even though it's picking up steam in different states. Okay, so that's two. Here come the rest of the pillars of the new pro-life movement, Catholics that founded it. Now it is they call it a secular movement. It's a secular organization. However, they have a Catholic deacon on board, and they are very much, the woman founder was a Franciscan University graduate, and okay, well-known Catholics. Another pillar, women's rights and justice. Okay, that's starting to get a little nebulous. That could mean a lot of things. War, that's a big subject. And that is a Prudential judgment thing, by the way. It's kind of a massive subject all of its own. And we already have an anti-war movement, but that's, okay, let's put that under pro-life. Death penalty, okay, that's another Prudential judgment issue, which I'll get to at the end here. It's not a non-negotiable for Catholics. It's not intrinsically evil. And it's something that pro-lifers never had to agree upon in order to work together to end abortion. We have a lot of evangelicals, we have a lot of Catholics who are pro-death penalty and some that are against the death penalty, and we're always able to work together under the umbrella of pro-life issues. So, okay, but now, no. If you are not for, you know, if you're for the death penalty, you can't really be pro-life. Okay. Healthcare is another pillar of the new pro-life movement. That's pretty broad. Poverty. That's pretty broad. The environment, that's huge. And it has a lot of already organizations that are dealing with that issue, correct? So, okay. Gun violence. And this is interesting, and no pun intended, but they have a bullet list under the gun violence pillar that talks about mandates and waiting periods and abolition of things. It all has to do with the law. They want the law to regulate what we can do with guns in this country. But remember, the law doesn't work when it comes to abortion. We don't want to deal with the law. But boy, we want to deal with the law and the public square when it comes to Second Amendment rights. Okay, and then finally, the last pillar is social and political involvement. Okay, what does that even mean? And by the way, if they're just lauding social and political involvement in general, well, that's what the actual pro-life movement has been doing for 45 years. We already do that. So at least 8 out of the 11 are not non-negotiables, but are rather a litany of Democrat social programs and leftist ideology. Okay, this is exactly how the left is able to water down the pro-life movement and water down the anti-abortion movement and anti-euthanasia movement. I mean, what's not covered in there? Everything is covered in there. They could have included jaywalking. That's a pro-life issue, right? It's a life issue. Putting the cart in the corral after you go shopping. Someone could trip and kill themselves. These are all should be under the umbrella of sustaining life, right? And that's how they are operating. Put everything in there but the kitchen sink. And then if you don't agree with their leftist Democrat platform, which is all it is, then you are not pro-life. What are you? You are pro-birth. Have you heard that? You're not pro-life, you're just pro-birth. If you're not for all these other social programs, then you're not really pro-life. Okay, it's the old seamless garment argument all over again. So it leaves those who are against legal abortion and want to fight against legal abortion, it leaves us out in the cold. So I'm gonna skip ahead and I'm just gonna show you, because I am running out of time. I'm gonna tell you where that leads. The two co-founders of the new pro-life movement, these Catholics, one of them is Matthew Tyson, and he, up until recently, and he may still have it, I don't know, but on his Facebook profile, he was publicly promoting a radical pro-abortion candidate, Doug Jones, for the Senate. And, you know, a lot of people didn't like his opponent, Ray Moore, and that's fine. But for the leader of a pro-life, the founder of a pro-life movement, to support a 100% 9-month abortion supporter that is lauded by NARAL and lauded by Planned Parenthood as an excellent candidate, it's scandalous. Pro-lifers don't endorse publicly pro-abortion candidates, do they? Unless you're a Democrat, right? And then there's the other Catholic founder Rebecca Bratton Weiss. And by the way, she has written publicly that she will never again attend a March for Life. She attends those other women's marches, but she will never attend the March for Life and is, quote, no longer with this movement. I don't think it's a movement for life. But if you listen to what she writes, you'll hear the pro-choice talking points. Listen very carefully. Quote, the reality is that holding fast to our pro-life, us, holding fast to our demand that women should be denied access to safe and legal abortion from the moment of conception may have been counterproductive. That's a pro-choice talking point. It's counterproductive for us to say that women should not have legal abortion. She also says, every abortion destroys something precious. Yeah, a human life, we should call it that. Yes, abortion hurts women, but the emphasis of the pro-life movement should be recalibrated away from campaigning for the abolition of legal abortion to creating a society in which no woman will feel that not having an abortion would hurt her more. It's true that abortion can be physically and psychologically harmful to a woman. Can be. No, it always is. But what the pro-life movement, that's us, fails to note is that in many cases, not choosing abortion will hurt women more. This is the founder of a pro-life movement who is saying that in many cases, it's more harmful to women not to have an abortion. I read that to my husband. He said, does she work for Planned Parenthood? Who is this? These are the two Catholic leaders of the new pro-life movement, the tail of the serpent. Watch for what happens. They are talking points for Planned Parenthood. That is, they may say they're against abortion, and maybe they are in their hearts, but that's the same thing as a politician who says, I'm against abortion, but. Okay? Okay, so in light of everything that you've heard, I just want to go back and say again that there's a legitimate line between what is non-negotiable and what is prudential judgment. And I'm going to skip a few of these because I have more from Bishop Olmsted. You can read the booklet. But even John Paul II, he wrote that the right to life, the thing that we're not supposed to worry about anymore, you know, in the public square, trumps everything else. He said, above all, the common outcry which is justly made on behalf of human rights, for example, the right to health, to home, to work, to family, to culture, all of it is false and illusory if the right to life, the most basic and fundamental right and the condition for all other personal rights, is not defended with the maximum determination. Which you do not hear from the new pro-life movement. They don't care about legal abortion. And even things that are more weighty in Catholic teaching, like even death penalty, which, you know, it's pretty serious, you should weigh that, you know, whether or not we like that. But even Pope Benedict said, not all moral issues have the same moral weight as abortion and euthanasia. For example, if a Catholic were to be at odds with the Holy Father on the application of capital punishment or the decision to wage war, he would not for that reason be considered unworthy to present himself to receive Holy Communion. There may be a legitimate diversity of opinion even among Catholics about waging war and applying the death penalty, but not, however, with regard to abortion and euthanasia. There's a clear line. It's not to be confused, and it is not muddled. It is the teaching of our Catholic Church. Don't let anyone bully you into accepting that unless you accept the democratic, left-wing, ideological, progressive, identity politics platform, that you are somehow not sufficiently Catholic. Listen to what your church says in the public square and know what the true issues are, the non-negotiables versus all else that we are free to disagree about. You have church teaching on your side. So anyway, thank you for listening.